good afternoon. So welcome to another week of the Friday seminar here at Portland State University. I'm Dr. Kelly Clifton, a professor in civil engineering and one of the instructors for the course this term. It is my pleasure to introduce today Jan Nederwijn, who is a planner in the city, or planner and engineer in the city of Delft, the Netherlands. And if you haven't had the pleasure of going to the city, I can tell you that it is, they've done a wonderful job dealing with the challenges of multimodal transportation, which is not to say that they don't have other challenges. But I'm hoping Jan can talk to us today about some of his experiences and some of the novel things that they're doing there.
Okay, thank you. I will give you a 30-40 minute talk about the city of Delft and my transport planning over there. I'm a transport engineer working for the city of Delft since 2002. I developed the Delft transport plan. It's on top of this list. And I'll explain you something about how I've done that together with my group to make cycling the dominant mode of transport in my city. And I can tell you today I've succeeded. It is. And with this presentation, maybe you get some clues or thinking for yourself how you can change your city to more bike transport. But I will show you all modes of transport, not only cycling, so you get an overview, because I want a working transportation system with all modes of transport. I divided my presentation in some categories. First, I tell you something about the total transportation plan. Then I will focus on road design. It gives you some views about the car-free city. And at the end, I'll show you the things we're dealing with today, and that's bike congestion. Now we have areas where we have so much bicycles, it doesn't work anymore. And we're getting new kinds of problems and trying to put in car solutions in our bike network to solve these problems. That will be the final part of my presentation. First, some small things. The Netherlands, where is it? It's in Europe. It's the smallest country over here, 100 miles east-west, 200 miles north-south. And the city of Delft is located in the busiest part of the Netherlands, with the major cities, The Hague and Rotterdam, nearby. We are a very old city, built, started 800 years ago. And we have a long history. And that's what how the city looks like today on the Central Market Square. These are some basic facts about Delft. The area has about 4 million inhabitants. The whole country has 17 million. And only 100,000 are living in the city of Delft. And 13,000 people living in my city are students. So we're a student-dominated city. And that's very good for bike transport because students are champion cyclists. And the whole university in Delft has about 22,000 students. Some distances is important. Delft-De Hague, 9 kilometers, can be cycled. Delft-Rotterdam, a little bit further, 15 kilometers. If you're a good cyclist, you can do that. Well, Amsterdam Airport and Rotterdam Airport nearby. On the left side, you see our street map in 1645. The downtown area, and that is still visible today. The Central Market Square, over here in the middle, that has been there for 800 years. And this is our downtown area. The size of that area is about 500 by 500 meters, so maybe 600 by 600 yards. That means from the market square, it's pretty good walkable to all corners of the city. The city has grown. That's a two-day picture. Still, the central markets is visible over here. In the downtown area, it's the same area you can see over here. And the city has grown to a size about 5 by 5 kilometers. That's a perfect cycling distance. It's a half an hour cycling, about 3 miles, so everybody can go cycling if he likes to. Well, as a starting point, we had some American-style planning in the 60s. We decided we should transform our city to a car-oriented city. We started demolishing houses, building big lanes. And a certain view we said, oh, we are destroying our city. We have teared down the city walls to build a beautiful highway in our city. And we stopped it. We said, there's no good. It will not work. we cannot build a city with such wide roads and such space used for cars. In the 70s, we decided we will build a bike network plan. In the year 2002, when I came to the city, they said we need an update, a bigger plan. Our city has grown, and we were forgotten to invest in bicycle infrastructure. We made two plans, transportation plan, the local transportation plan, that's on top, and that's the front page of the plan. And the second one, on request of our politicians, make a quick plan for first visible actions for cyclists, the bicycle action plans. And our motto was Delft Cycles, and we make to try and have a sustainable transportation system. What I will show in the next slide is some elements of our transportation plan. Those were the key items, the key goals we like to achieve. And this is our starting model split. In Dutch, you see the words in colors, the translation. When we started in 2005, we had a model split of 50% car use. People living in Delft, going to the downtown area, 50% of them chooses a bike. And that is all pretty good, but we want to get that number higher. Public transport is very low, and it has to do with the short distances. If you only have to travel for 4 or 3 kilometers to the downtown center, it's faster to go by bike than the public transport. So people that were in the public transport didn't have a bike, didn't have a car, so they were dependent on public transport. Walking is also a huge number, because if many people already live in downtown, they will walk. It's a pretty good transportation system, and still we wanted to have it increased. But that we were seeing that the numbers were going down from cycling, because the city has grown and become wider, and we didn't meet up with the transportation and the bike infrastructure. A general map of Delft. The downtown area is always over there, with historical streets. And the city has grown to the west and grown to the south, with all kinds of new neighborhoods. And we did some infrastructure that everybody could go to the city center, but we forgot to make cross relations that way. Now, we did some analysis. First, air quality. In the Netherlands, we have some standards about air quality, and these roads didn't meet the standards. So we had too much pollution, of course, from cars, but also from industry that's coming by, and we had a goal to solve these problems. We chose two options. We did some restrictions on energy engines of cars, keep out some diesel engines or outdated cars, and put our buses on natural gas. That's one solution. And the other one, maybe we can influence air pollution by road design. If we lower the speeds, we can improve the air quality. We had noise. That's for some reason, most of the same roads have a noise problem, because if you have a high volume number of cars, then noise will become a problem. And we said, well, it's very difficult to solve noise problems. But we say if we will let the city grow with more houses, we have more jobs, we're targeting not to increase the level of the noise levels. That was one of the goals we sent to ourselves. Transport safety, that's the same roads where we had some black spots where many accidents would happen. And we tried to solve them by road design. In the first edition of my report, I wrote down we have about 200 accidents of crashes where people get injured. It was hard to point out that on which location that would be. It was spread over the city. And 200 is still a lot, but with my original solutions solving black spot, I couldn't get that number down. And I made an analysis, what kind of roads do have the most crashes? And still again, it were these red roads. It were not residential street, it were not highway or arterial streets, some streets that had a mixture of living in the street and high car volumes. That were the most dangerous locations. And we thought we could change the road design of that kind of roads. Maybe then we can get the number of accidents down. I've said two times, reduce speed. I've got a fire department. They have a department location over here, and their standards are within 7 minutes, I could reach the borders of the city limit for every fire. So I like the speed. And dear John, I've got one restriction. These roads, that's the roads that I use. Forget about speed bumps. That's my complete network. And I like to get speeds down for safety reasons. But I also have to do on this constraint. Well, some constraints. And then I've got also some other departments in my city, the ecology department, and they said, I want this network from you, connecting all the parks I've got with greens, with greening zones, to combine these parks to one big network. So small animals can use the city as a nature reserve. You know we are a city, but if you combine parks, we can get a better quality for ecology. That were all the goals, all the promises to the city, we will solve this all. Everybody seems to be happy, but how can we solve that? Well, we give it a try. And I go down to all the modes of transports to solve traffic problems. The first one, if we want public transport, if we want good public transport, we will focus on light rail. We have a large group of people that do not like bus, but will enter light rail. Light rail is more predictable, higher quality, higher speed, more comfort. Dus we made the network based on light rail. And it looks like this. That are the black dotted lines in our network. If I focus on the complete system, the first step is national rail. It's the purple line. We've got two railroad stations. And you've got the frequency of about 10, 12 trams an hour going to The Hague or going to Rotterdam. That's a pretty good connection. It's a national, statewide system. And if you are a student, you get a card for free public transport. So it's heavily used. That's how our city is connected with the rest of the world and with the airport and in Amsterdam. For regional transport, we try to have light rail connections. Tram line 1, zoals she called it, is already available, starting in a residential area, going to the downtown area and heading north to the city of The Hague. So she step in here, within 1 hour you're at the beach at the city of The Hague. And we made a plan for tram line 19. That one is under construction. That's going to the campus of the university, that's over here, collecting all the students and also going north to another part of The Hague. And the last thing we wished was tram line 37, that would connect some new suburbs of The Hague in the neighborhood of Rotterdam with the city of Delft. And if you look with some imagination, you can see I've got a spider network of light rail connections. With the buses coming in from the rural areas, we decided the concept high speed, few stops, so commuters can travel fast into the city. And on the basic of the network, we did some blue lines, bus lines covering the whole city, so everybody could have a stop nearby. And that was focused on people that depend on public transport, don't have a job, but like to travel somewhere. So they cover the whole area. And if the bus doesn't shoot you, there's also a minivan for people, that elderly people or handicapped people that will transport you. The lowest one is the most expensive system, and we try to get as many people out of this bus onto, out of the minivan onto the normal public transport. I will try for you. It's hard to reach. Public. This is an example of a new road concept, railroad station Delft Zuid. 1 month ago, they decided to build 4 tracks. On the national rail, we already have 2, but decided there will be money for 4 tracks, so we can develop a new railroad station, Delft Zuid. And on that station, we also add a bike lane underground, so we have a tunnel, bike tunnel connection for public transport. So if you make a design, we need public transport combined with bike, combined with pedestrians, and then that station that will work. This is an artist impression. And what you can see, 14 trains an hour on Delft Central Station, though we have when there are 4 tracks, and 6 trains each hour both directions on Delft South. And this station will be the heavily used for the university. That's the way, if I stimulate public transport, car volumes might come down. That's the thought we have. We made the conclusion, if we add a light rail to Delft, the car volume will drop with 8%. So we get 8% of the people out of the car into the light rail. Car transport. I cannot make a plan with ignoring the cars. So we said, we will solve the areas that are most congested. Yes, I do add lanes, I do add infrastructure, especially on locations that are very car dependent, like business districts or industry. They get more lanes for me. They get more capacity. So in the plan, we add some infrastructure for cars. And now I step to the most important part of my transportation plan, and that is road design. By designing roads, I think I can make the transportation system safe and make it more predictable and better be used. I have a standard of the national government, and they say you've got 3 kinds of roads in the Netherlands for cities: highways, arterials, or residential streets. Each design, each standard has its own design standard, its own rules, and its own speed limit. So every residential street has a basic set of design elements which makes it a residential street. And they get a speed limit of 30. To convert to you 20 miles per hour. So if you're driving a residential street in the Netherlands, it always be speed limit maximum 20. And on the design of that street you can see this is a residential street. And the same they did for the arterial and for the highway design. For example, if you have a residential street, you will cycle on that street. If it's an arterial, you get the protected bike lane. And if it's a highway and you have an intersection, there will always be traffic lights and protected bike lanes. That's the concept. And it's made by traffic engineers, so it was looking at a very good traffic engineer handbook. They have all design rules, where to paint the markers, where to paint the arrows, how it should look like. I showed that book to my urban developers, my city planners, and ecologists. And they said to me, if you will apply these standards to the roads you have got in Delft, no way. But what will happen if you do that? It will be designed for traffic engineers and looking that traffic is dominant. And that's not how we like to build cities where traffic is dominant. Traffic is needed to let the city operate, but should it be dominant? It should support the city. And my urban planner said, make something different. We had some problems with that design. If you make standards and say how big everything should be, well, looking at my city, the streets are already there. Especially in the historic areas, I run out of space. I cannot handle 4 lanes of traffic, including bike lanes and a special lane for bus traffic. It doesn't fit. Even a smaller design, it doesn't fit. I'm running out of space. Also, if my ecologist says I want something green, it was not in the standard. Stronger, I had competing claims. Somebody likes a bike lane, somebody likes a bus lane, or should I take out the parking lane? I had an awful lot of discussion. People said we have to drive fast because we have to go to a destination. That doesn't work. And that was in the concourse of policymakers, but also in the political context. Some people supported cars, some people supported public transport, and some people supported bikes. Please help me with an option that we can put in all kinds of interests. So the standard doesn't fit good in my city. And especially, all the roads are marked for you out that have problems of air quality, of traffic safety, where these roads were running out of space and had to do something different. And then we decided to forget about the national standards and to do something for ourselves, what is better, what is safer. And we marked some roads, painted them green, and we said, these roads will not fit the national standard. I cannot make a traffic engineering design that will fit that locations or that will look beautiful. And we call them a new road concept, in Dutch, Wijkontsluitingsweg. So if you can translate it for me at the end of this session, giving me the name how you should call it, you can help me for my next presentation. But always, maybe you can also help yourself, because this concept might fit in many roads you've had in your cities. What kind of roads are that? We think that are roads with mixed use. I need them for my connecting facility, getting to the city. So I need the road capacity. These roads have to carry an awful lot of traffic, 10,000 cars or more. But it's also roads with many destinations on both sides. There are shops or houses that are connected to that road and that are dependent on that road. So that the roads needed for transport, but also needed for living. And that are the green roads. And then we marked them. We said, let's lower the speed limit, 10 kilometers per hour. Try to make a design 40 kilometers per hour, 25 miles per hour. Try to make a design, not a sign, but a design. So I don't need to put a speed sign that it will be 25. No, I make a design what invents you to drive 25 kilometers per hour. And if I do so, traffic comes down. If there is a crash or an accident, the impact will be lower, that will be safer. You have more time to react. If you do so, the noise levels will go down and the air pollution will go down. So I can deal with all the problems that I mentioned in my first slides. Yeah, that's the last sentence over there. First, he did some exercise, not looking directly at one specific street, but make some sketches. How should such a design work out? One of the things we like to do, make crossing a street easier, because if people are living on a street, they like to cross and go to the other side. Well, we thought in our concept we should use an island in the middle, make the lanes wider, to present a location where people will cross, and it will reduce speed and it will make it easier to cross. If you stand here as a pedestrian and you cross the side, the street, you only have to look one way and have to deal with one lane of traffic. So you can first cross to here and then first cross the second part. You don't need the traffic light anymore because it's easier. We tried it with a roundabout. If you build a roundabout in a busy street, speeding is impossible because you cannot speed on a roundabout. It also gives priority for the cyclist because a car has to stop for a bike. We tried to design with light rail connections within the middle. So we made some concepts. And there's a list of design elements that you can use. The first one, make lanes smaller. Smaller lane, the speeds will go down because you have more effort staying on that lane. The special median, do something in the middle instead of two yellow colored lines, do something different for making the road smaller. Put attention markers, make it visible that there's something happening. On this area, we said, okay, there will be attention because we make a median, but if I cross a different surface, a different pavement, then also people know that it will be a difference, that there will be somebody crossing. And take out as many traffic lights as possible. If you make a good design and make intersections smaller, you can get rid of a lot of traffic lights. And that saves you a lot of maintenance cost and makes it also the transportation system that has a that is faster for all modes of transport. This was the first road we tried to the new concept on, the Ruijs-de-Berenbroekstraat. We were happy because the sewer systems had to be replaced completely, so we could start from scratch. This is an old example, all pictures of the old road. It had bike lanes painted already, but it was a wide road. It had some markers in the middle, but it also had four traffic lights, two in the middle and one at the beginning of the end of the street. Parking on the street, several kinds of houses. We start remodeling that street. And it looked like this. This is the new design. This is a simulation, because if I have to convince politicians, and I start with a technical AutoCAD drawing, half of the room will not understand what it is. So make it visible, make artists in practice, make a simulation to make it visible. And so we did. You see a special median in the middle. This will narrow the road visibly, not in the real world. It's still the original standard of 3 meters wide, 10 feet, 11 feet for a lane. But taking out some space, make it a different pavement and do it on this side and on the side of the street, the driving lane looks like 8 feet. A truck will fit on it, but also for a car it will look much smaller. And if it looks smaller, you will drive slower. That's one trick we put it in. And you see an example of presenting a location where people will cross. This is the real world. Median in the middle, with special cobblestone bricks, fixed in concrete, a tension marker. It looked like bricks over there, but it's street paint. It's cheaper for maintenance costs, and present the intersections. And it worked. We did a measurement, counting cars and measuring speeds and measuring transportation time. We took out two traffic lights, so the result was a car crossing the Ruijs-de-Berenbroekstraat was faster than in the original situation, because we didn't have traffic lights anymore. We had no waiting times if you have to cross the street. That was zero. The accidents went down to zero. No accidents at all. And the speed that we measured was 40 kilometers per hour. And that's the design speed we caught is the V40-85. So 15% of the cars were speeding, driving faster than 40 kilometers per hour. But it's a good design, because if you achieve the design speed, then you've got a good design. So this was, from nature on, 40 kilometers per hour, 25 miles per hour. It worked. And now we are converting all these streets, one for after each other, for new street designs. And you can make it complicated. That used to be a street with 17 lanes of traffic going in and out. And we converted it to a roundabout with one lane for cars each direction. And these streets carry a lot of traffic, 10,000 cars for each direction. And it works, and it looks very complicated. It has a light rail in the middle. It is traffic lights are on it, but not on every leg. We only put traffic light on a bus crossing over here and a light rail crossing over there. And this used to be, in the old situation, an ocean of asphalt. It will fit in North Korea or in East Germany in history terms. It was one big oversized location. Two lanes of cars with left and right turns could be transferred to one lane and no left or right turns. This one became safe. The car-free area. It used to be this situation today. I'll speed up a little. We had a parking lot on the downtown Market Square. And we are a very touristic city, but you could park 80 cars on a central Market Square. Well, you could park 20 tourist buses. And so we did. So everybody getting out of the bus, looking at a parking area with parking cars, and if they want to make a picture of the town or of the church, they could photograph their own bus. We took it out. First as a compromise, take out 40 cars and take out the buses. And a few years later, we did it all. And then the terraces appear. And if you do so, you see an example of a solution with the half part is parking cars and the other part become a market square. And in this concept, we say we make the whole downtown area car free. Only if you have permit, you may drive your car and you may cycle everywhere. But you are a guest. The dominant mode of transport in the car free area is walking, but you're allowed cycling everywhere. Also in shopping streets, during shopping hours, also if you had a market with on the central market square, you are allowed to cycle. But you know, you are the guest. So if you don't have the space to cycle, you have to walk, but we will not ticket you for cycling, because it's allowed. And this is the area that's completely car-free, and if you will enlarge it, residents has asked to this. And then we do a vote, if 70% is in favor, then we add the area. This is a way how we block the car-free area. Only if you've got a permit, the model will go down. And recently we replaced these things for only using with cameras. So you get a ticket, but you don't use the bollards anymore because this is an expensive system. You get some car-free opportunities to get out more. IKEA used cargo bikes. So if you buy something by IKEA, you can rent a bike for $10 and bring your stuff to your own home. They have some design problems because the car would flip over if you were unloading, so they are modifying the concept. But they try to. This is an example if you have to move a large group of children. They will fit in 10 or 8. And it reduced the vans from schools going to a day system where they keep them for the rest of the day. You can transport by this kind of bikes, saves some traffic to schools. Over here, that's the tourist one. If you like to see the city, you can do it by that electric vehicle with a driver. The one on the right is used for business areas to reduce short transport car volumes. And on top you see a small cargo bike and a little electric van for replacing delivery trucks in the downtown area. So if you're pushing big cars and traffic out, innovation starts on other kinds of vehicles to solve minor problems. And if the market square is empty, you can do festivals like this. Bike transport. This guy is cycling on the electric bike in a pedestrian car-free area. And he's old, so I was looking for a cyclist that was not a student to show you that everybody will cycle in a downtown cycling street. This is a way to compare all modes of transport. And you can do it in your city. Start your own competition. Pick out cities that have the same kind of problems, the same skill, and judgment on all these aspects. How safe is your city? How dense is your network? What's your bike use? What's the competition against cars? Are you faster as a bike or as a car? How good is your bike policy that you have to written down the things? This is done by the Cycling Association of the Netherlands, and they compare all the cities and showing who's the best. This is a score of the city of Delft. That's the standard this bike association thinks you should have, and that's the average scores of all cities that are in your benchmark. And if you start the competition, always every city wants to be the first. That's a way to stimulate cycling and get cycling better in your cities. We draw a bike network. I've seen Portland and Boston, they take a bike network. It's easy to draw your lines. It's good to have them, but the next step would build it. Make protected bike lanes. Solve the missing links. Then you get a really good working system. In our system, you see bike lanes were missing in the northwest and in the southeast. So that's where we will spend the money, enlarging the bike network. We built a bike transportation network. We used it to calculate, if I add the bridge, how much cyclists will it use? And how much shorter will be the distance for cyclists? We built bike priority lanes. In the car-free area, walking is dominant and bike cycling is the guest. In these streets, cycling is dominant and a car is a guest. We need some car transport in these locations, but the bike volumes are much higher. This is the elderman showing the first bike lane in Delft. So as a car, you may drive over the cycle path, but at a low speed, because you are a guest. Solving problems for parking your bike at home. Some houses don't have a bicycle shed, so we put them on the sidewalk, or we take out some parking places and add parking facilities for your bike. Especially in the downtown area where the houses are small and many people are living, they have problems with parking their bicycles. Put bicycle parking at light rail stops. If we see a bike parked to a light rail stop, we put a bike space by it. And if you see another bike, we put another one. Putting bike facilities next to a light rail stop will increase the catchment area of that light rail stop and will increase public transport. This is the bike shop parking of our central station. This is the underground facility. This covers 5,000 places. On the right side, this is too small. So outside, we built another facility for 3,000 places. And you see it's in the basement of the new railroad station. On top, platform for the buses. In the basement, the bikes. And one level below, the trains. Sometimes bikes get stolen. I had 2 attempts with my bike on the central station in this year. So I'm very annoyed that it's really an issue. But what happens if a bike is stolen and we find them back? Nobody will come picking it up. So we put the market square on with bikes that has been recovered. And we show to the people, yes, we do find bikes back, so please give an effort looking at the database that if your bike might have been found. And we found a lot of good quality bikes back. Please take them with you. If they do not show up, then we ship these bikes to South Africa. The last part of my presentation, bike congestion. On one area is the main entrance of the university. The numbers has gone so high that we have traffic people, stopping the bicycle flows for cars to cross. So, we are in the newspaper. Car driver loses from cycling student. You can wait here for 1 hour before there is space for you to cross the bike flow. That car over there is trying to enter a residential area, and it's the only way in, so he has to cross this flow of traffic. 14,000 bikes on that intersection. And with the other markers, we have the same problem with a little bit lower volume. How can we solve that? If I make the bike lane wider, I do nothing with the bike volume. Because, the cyclists will cycle wider, but the numbers will not go down. And what we decided to do is extend the bike network. Add more facilities. If I convert this street to a bike street as well, maybe some traffic that's over there will move to this part. So add an additional facility. And that's what we decided. Make there more bike lanes, make more routes, that the volumes will slow down. This is a bike count. 90, that means 90 bikes per minute on the intersection. And we need at least 6 seconds for a car, an interval of 6 seconds if you can cross the flow. So you see it is almost impossible. These are the hours the college, the university starts or changes for a new lesson. And you can see the peak is 5 minutes before the college starts. And at the end of the day, it's 5 minutes after. I've asked the university, maybe a suggestion, why should every class start at the same time? If you shift it 15 minutes, then my peak is gone and I get lower volumes. And I'm still pressing on the university, do something at your classes times, otherwise I cannot handle these peaks. And this peak will be in my bike network, but in my public transport network as well. If you look at the 10,000 places at the central station, all the students will pick out one train that fits best to their time schedule, and everybody will leave the bike station at the same moment. So we have to spread out the volumes. Well, make your bike network wider means spending infrastructure. Every circle on this map is a tunnel crossing a freeway or crossing the railroad tracks or crossing a waterway. Every circle on the track means an investment of at least 10 million euros. And I'm working on it. I'm pretty successful. You see some are already done. They are green. And the yellow ones, we are working on to gather the money and or making the design. Number 5, that was a decision that was made recently. So that will be the next bicycle lane, bicycle tunnel crossing the railroad track. If you like to improve your bike system in the United States, I've made for you 3 steps. The first one, make bikes visible on the street. Start painting. Not only what you call the conflict zone, start painting the complete bike lane. So in the mind of the car driver, he knows a cyclist will be on the whole street. Make them visible. Even if you park your car and you see a green lane, that means, oh yes, it's a cycle. I can expect a bike. Improve comfort. You can do something in the quality of your roads with all the bumps. Smooth it out. Spend some money on it, on good maintenance. If you're on that level, go to step 2. Traffic safety might become an issue. Solve your black spots as soon as possible, but that can damage your investment in cycling. Look at the traffic lights. Can it be faster, more rapidly? In Delft, we said we had the cycle time over 20 minutes, or 2 minutes, and we said go and bring it back to 90 seconds. Even the busiest intersection tried to make a cycling time for 90 seconds. That means a reducement of waiting time for at least 30 seconds for the bike. It can easily be done. And make what you call protected bike lanes. And think about your road system. What are the materials that have a protected bike lane? Work on that kind of concepts. And at the highest level, start spending the big money, adding more infrastructure, special bridges or tunnels to make distances shorter. And as a result, cycling will be a serious alternative for cars on short travel distance. Don't expect people to drive 20 miles. So I will judge my own program, my transportation program. I've done it all, I think. So I filled in the score of the Cycling Association and the scores of Delft today. This was the old result. And today I think I'm at this level. I thank you.
Your plans for the city is like 10 years from now. With the involvement of like self-driving cars and electrical cars, is there any consideration in your planning to involve these cars to reduce air pollution in the city?
Yeah, my planning was for 20 years. We're already a long way ahead. We have a university. They have some self-driving cars. I offered them, I would like to be a test case. And I can offer you the most complicated situation, self-driving cars combined with cycling traffic. I think it will take a long time before they can solve that problem. And to make it a little bit less ambitious, we figured out maybe city distribution in the car-free area at the low speed could be a next level. But I wonder about if I have a self-driving car. It's full of electronica and equipment. So maybe the energy consumption of that car can be higher than an ordinary car. Dus I am not sure if I solve all my energy problems. But I think it will take a long time to be perfectly in a citywide system. But we are open for research and study. Some people are thinking maybe a people mover without a special lane to one of the light rail or railroad stations could be a first option for doing that. So we are thinking on it, and we are free for experimentations.
So another question somewhere. Yes. Frank Koster is my name. Do you tax your bikes?
Tech or?
Tax.
Tax, no.
No.
It's for free. We are thinking about asking a price for bike parking.
It's a multi-dollar business to build such a huge biking facilities. And when we reach 10,000 bikes underground, the undercut is completely filled up with bike parking, with car parking, or with the railroad track. So I cannot enlarge the bike system, the bike garage anymore. And what we are doing is we have a system that already knows how long a bike is parked, and we're thinking about putting a price on it for the second day you park your bike. Maybe not for all spots, but on the spots that are the best location to push out long-term parking. But we had the problem, if you have had a bike and you didn't use it, you park it at the central station. Well, I'm not spending so much millions for bikes that have not been used. We take out about 2,000 bikes a year in our railroad station because they are completely out of order or they are not used anymore. We call them orphan bikes. We take them out. If your bike is not used for 2 or 4 weeks, we take them out. And we ship them to South Africa to get a bike facility that is used by people who would like to park bikes and use public transport. Dus yes, there will be some pricing maybe if we cannot solve the parking problem anymore. But we try to convince people not to park, use your bike for long-term parking.
Yeah, thank you, Jan. My name is Roger Geller. You mentioned that you did some modeling showing an 8% drop in car use with the introduction of light rail. How confident are you in your demand modeling for transportation, and how well does it handle bicycle modeling?
Bike modeling is very difficult.
Most of the money is earned for modeling for cars. 90% of all the money is spent on car models, 10% on public transport, and 0.1 for bike modeling. And that says something about the quality of these models. Dus I'm not really confident about if I really catch 8% with public transport. But what gives me some confidence, we have started counting cars since the year 2002. At about 100 locations, continuously, day and night. And the car volume has grown, but is going down again, and we are on the same level of cars volumes as we were in the year 2002, but we have more residents and more jobs in our city. So the growth is not in the car volumes, it's in the public transport and in the bike facilities. And for me, that's an evidence that investing money in cycling can reduce car volumes. And we know with our predictions for light rail, we did a calculation for light rail 1 before we built that one, in 1995, and the year of opening, we achieved the number of passengers that we expected to have 10 years later. So if I have some thoughts that bike lanes of light rail will attract traffic, yes, I really believe in that concept. We also hear from people, I don't like a bus, but I do like light rail because it has more quality, more comfort, less shaking, more reliable, and then keep on investing in it. You feel very good about investing in that kind of public transport infrastructure.
You allow mopeds on your bike lanes. How does that affect your planning and design of those facilities?
We have got two kinds of mopeds. We usually allow them all.
But mopeds were allowed to drive 40 kilometers per hour. Well, most cyclists don't drive faster than 12 or 14 kilometers per hour, 10 miles. And that was a risk. We asked the national government to change the rules, and they did so, and now it's for mopeds who drive fast, are forced to drive on the car on the lane. And now we're left over with mopeds that have speed restriction, they cannot drive faster than 25 kilometers per hour. and they are allowed without a helmet on the bike lane. So we can figure out if you do not wear a helmet, if you do a blue license plate, then you're a moped with a restricted speed. And that is safe. And in practice, teenagers who like to speed choose for the fast moped, drive on the car lane, and elderly people with the other moped, with the low speed limit, merge with the cyclist, and that's going pretty well.
You said so simply that you asked the national government to do that, and they said yes. Could you touch on maybe if there was any feedback or how you went about from making that argument?
We wrote an article in a Dutch
transportation magazine, and we already saw in the statistic data everywhere in the Netherlands that we had a problem with mopeds on bike lanes. They were dominant in the transportation system. And in that article, we suggested allow mopeds to drive faster in the built-up areas, give them 10 kilometers or more, so they are allowed to drive 45, and put them then on the carway. And that suggestion helped some other people in the national government. Okay, under that condition, it will work. And then, surprisingly, it worked. It was the right question, the right letter, the right article, on the right moment. And we saw a huge reduction of conflicts between mopeds and bicycles. We see an increase with mopeds and cars, but it was not that high. The total balance was better.
Amanda Howell. Kind of following along those lines. When you were looking at making the city center car free and taking away that parking, what did the process look like? I'm just imagining that happening here, and there would be, I think, a lot of pushback. So how did that go?
We are a historic city. We are
in the top 10 list of cities visited by tourists because of our quality and our history and the royal family, with all the things in Delft. And there are some commercial parties behind it. We like to stimulate that historic city center. And they were also showing that using a market square for parking 80 cars, instead of giving all the restaurants terraces on the same location, that doesn't make sense. And if you offer 80 cars, 100 of the cars or 200 of the cars will try to find the last spot on that location because it's the best place to park your car. So there was some support in the downtown area to get the cars out. But we had to solve the parking problem, and we decided we built parking facilities outside the inner city on the locations where the city wall used to be. And that's a walkable distance to the central market square, 250 meters, 300 yards. And do it slowly. First he took out 40 parking spaces, let the people see that it was an advantage. Then some of the restaurants could offer a terrace and double their profit. Well, wait 2 years and all the other restaurants will ask, can you take out the other 40 cars? And so you steadily build it up. We showed a final picture where we might end, but we had a stepwise. First the streets where we were pretty sure that you have a reason to walk, that it's worth walking, and that it's quality to walking. If you had a good support in that street. And it took us about 20 years to the area we've got today. Now we are satisfied because every street where we think it's worth walking is car free. Just take your time and start at the best location and find your support in the people we are living or working in that street.
I'm Marina, and in these areas that the cars are not allowed, are there any conflicts between bicycles and pedestrians?
That's a big discussion in the Netherlands.
We decided cycling is allowed in every pedestrian area. Some other cities said, no, it's not allowed during shopping hours. It's not allowed at all. We have less conflicts and less letters than the cities which do not allow it. What will happen in our view if you say it's not allowed and people still cycle? on the street, you get an argument between a pedestrian and a cyclist from, hey, you shouldn't be here because it's not allowed. And they start fighting each other and blaming us that we didn't solve it properly. And if we say, this is a pedestrian area, you're a guest, behave like a guest. We didn't get these letters because it's allowed. They will be solved on the street. And surprisingly, also students on that locations behave like guests. So I do not believe in rules say don't do this or don't do this. We try to design a situation where people will behave like human beings. If the bike volume is very high, it will not work anymore. In that situation, you should build a bike lane through the downtown area and make clear this is the area where you can expect a lot of cyclists. And it takes, it takes time, it takes a lot of communication. But some people still think, get away of these bicycles. But I think we're doing a good job. I showed you the picture of the old man cycling on his electric bike. Oh, it looks safe. And we don't see accidents.
So here in Portland, there's a small but emerging discussion and economy around freight for bicycle-provided freight. Is that something that was specifically considered in your planning and design, or does that kind of just fall out of an overall approach to bikes?
You mean shops bringing food to your house, that kind of bike? That kind of concept was after we started with the car-free city. In the old days, you have to go to a restaurant and sit there. We had some discussion about the car-free areas to make it more clear. Bikes are a guest, but mopeds are not allowed. But after, that was the primary rule. But then restaurants started delivery services with mopeds with the higher speed option. So we changed the rules a little and we tried to solve the conflicts by talking to the restaurants that their drivers should behave. And also in the car-free area, car driving is allowed if you have got the permit or a reason to be there. So you report yourself to a special location and tell where you like to enter the car-free area. And if you got a good story, I cannot walk, you can get in. You can get in. Also, the car-free area does have some traffic. It can never be zero. You need deliveries. And with the delivery trucks, we are sizing them down. First, the biggest trucks are forced out. Then the little bit bigger trucks are forced to ask a permit. And we try to convert everybody to small delivery trucks to make the scale of the transport that will fit the historic city again.
I was just wondering, thank you for your presentation. I was wondering if businesses, when you first started with the car-free area, businesses are required to provide any sort of, in addition to parking, maybe like facilities, so like shower spaces or changing spaces for employees, or if that's part of it.
You push some kinds of shops out. If you're selling furniture or kitchens, we developed a new shopping center outside the downtown area, and we placed all the shops that were very car-dependent on that location. And we kept the shops that were smaller and selling business that could fit a car-free city center and didn't attract heavy traffic. That was one of the first steps. And we were focusing, if we are an historic city center, we need special shops that you only see in Delft. We need restaurants, terraces, and that's how we rebuild the city. And we have a city manager. If you would like to start a shop in the downtown area, then our city manager will talk to you and see what kind of shop you like to start. And he starts a discussion with you. Is this the right street for your shop? Or should you go in a different street in the downtown area to get a good mixture of shops? Or maybe choose a location outside the downtown area because you are so car dependent.
Thank you.
think we're out of time. Thank Jan for a wonderful talk today.